That I'll be covering is blockchain with Bitcoin as a case study. I'll be providing to you a very brief and quick introduction to blockchain as a technology. Okay. And let us continue with what our friend designed for us. Most people believe that Bitcoin and blockchain are one and the same thing. Okay, I mean, we always identify them as the same pieces, okay, as different names, alias names for the same topic. But in fact, it's not the reality. Okay, Bitcoin is the first application of blockchain. Okay, I can suggest it that way, but Bitcoin as the first application of blockchain, which was given to us by Nakamoto, Satoshi Nakamoto, in 2008. Okay, but can we claim that Bitcoin as a technology presented by Nakamoto? Okay, we don't know whether it's a person or a group. Okay, as claimed by our friend, right? Okay, is it a technology that Satoshi Nakamoto presented? It's again a big question, right? Yeah, it's a nice combination of existing simple techniques, okay, which were there by then, and people were using those techniques for decades together. Okay, he just combined them very nicely to come up with a nice technology which can build trust among otherwise untrustable group of participants, right? Okay, how it happens? Okay, you might have seen by now by various lectures, but anyway, we'll be very quickly summing up in today's talk. Right. What is blockchain? It's a decentralized ledger, right? Okay, I can call it as decentralized computation and information sharing platform that enables multiple authoritative domains. Okay. This is an interesting and important point to note down, who do not trust each other. Okay, there is no real trust among these multiple domains, right? But because of this decentralized computation tool, which is called as blockchain, okay, even though there is no trust, these domains come together to have a cooperation between them, coordination between them, and they can collaborate in rational decision making process. Okay, and in simple terms, it's a public ledger in which all committed transactions are stored in a chain of blocks, right? See, in the picture we can see a small chain of blocks, block one connected to block two, okay, block three and block n, which can be the recent one, right? How this chain connection happens, okay, if you know already, well and good, we'll revise it. Otherwise, we'll introduce it very shortly. Okay, these are the simple building blocks of blockchain. Okay, independently, each of them was existing for decades before 2008 also, right? But with the simple tricks coming together, okay, we have a nice technology called blockchain. Okay, our building blocks are hash function, digital signatures, public key infrastructure, Merkle tree, consensus. Okay, today we'll spend a bit about understanding hash functions, digital signatures, public key infrastructure, and Merkle tree. Okay, consensus we talked very briefly, and we'll spend our next lecture scheduled actually on 22nd, but I believe it is revised to 23rd. Okay, 23rd from 11:30 or so, we'll be spending our time discussing on consensus. Okay, the initial version of the schedule shows it as concerns in blockchains. You can revise it as consensus in blockchains. Yeah. I believe this presentation has very little about digital signatures. So before talking about hash functions, let us spend a bit about digital signatures. Okay. Digital signatures We all use a lock to lock our home. Okay, agree with me? assume you are two people at home, you and your spouse. Right, you have a different timings, okay, of job. So your wife already, wife or husband, okay, your spouse already went to work. And you want to go out now, so you want to lock your home. Okay, what you do? You will have a lock with two copies of keys. You will have one and your spouse will have one. Okay, so you go out by locking the door yourself with your key, and your spouse will come back with her copy of key and she'll open the lock with that key, right? Okay, so you and your spouse share a copy of the key, right? If I do a similar thing for a message encryption process where two parties share the same key, it is called symmetric crypto system, right? Okay, I mean both sender and receiver or encryptor and decryptor will have same key, right? Whereas digital signatures comes from a different kind of signature scheme called as public key crypto system or asymmetric key crypto system. What does this mean? Okay, nowadays you can see a different kind of door lock, automatic lock, where you just push a button from inside, okay, and just close the door, it will lock. You don't need a key to lock the room, right? But to open it, you need a key, right? Assume you have only one key with you, you give that key to your spouse, okay? Because you know by the time you come back, he or she will be at home, right? So you give key to her or him, right? And you just go out just by locking the door without having the key with you, okay? You just push the button, close the door, door is locked. You leave the home. Your spouse will come back, open the door with the key that is with the person, right? Now the door is open, so you can start using your home as it is, right? So here, the locking mechanism is different from unlocking mechanism. Okay, locking mechanism needs no special key. Okay, with that button, you can simply lock it. Okay, or anybody can lock it for that matter. Okay, so it's a public knowledge, right? Whereas unlocking, you need a key, right? That is secret to the person who possesses it, right? So such a different mechanism where we have a common key which is known to everyone, I mean, which is public for encryption process, and for decryption process, you need a secret device secret key, okay? Which is with only the owner of the system, right? Only they can decrypt it, right? Such a mechanism can be called or compared as public key crypto system. Here, with the simple reversal of process, okay, you can use that secret key for signing off, okay, for signing a message, right? And the public knowledge can be used for verifying the message, right? Usually these systems are used in banking and every other place where you need digital signatures, and Bitcoins also uses the similar thing. Okay, and in particular Bitcoin uses elliptic curve signature scheme, right? Okay, but our interest is not to go deep into cryptography. Okay, I stop this topic at that level and I'll continue with the other areas. Okay, and after talking a bit about hash functions, we'll come back to digital signatures in a very simpler form, right? And see how it is dealt in blockchains. Okay, so what is meant by hash function, cryptographic hash function? Okay, in general, hash function means it maps a larger space to a smaller space, right? Cryptographic hash function also does the similar thing. Okay, in particular, we use SHA-256, an algorithm which is well known in block bitcoins, right? Okay, what it does, it takes input of any length, okay, binary string input of any length, right, and maps it to string of size n, okay, start of 256 maps it to 256 bit output, right? So input of any length is mapped to 256 bit string, okay, binary string, right? So naturally we'll have collision, okay, because you are mapping a large space to a smaller space, right? But what is meant by collision resistance? Picking up an x and y such that they map to the same value, h of x is same as h of y, okay, getting hold of such an x and y is computationally difficult, right? We need such a requirement for any cryptographic hash function, and SHA-256 satisfies this requirement. Okay, again, what is SHA-256? What is elliptical cryptography? Such details we'll not spend our time to discuss. Okay, they are a bit more mathematical in nature, right? I mean, ECC is mathematical, whereas SHA-256 is a simple algorithm which just does repeated permutations and substitution processes. For that matter, any hash function in cryptography will be doing the same thing in different orders, right? You do various permutations and substitutions, okay? But for this, there is no great logic in any hash function for that matter, right? So apart from collision resistance, what else we need? We need another property called hiding, all right? What does it say? When you choose an R, okay, what is meant by this high entropy? Okay, in a random fashion, okay, nothing beyond that. Don't worry about such funny places, right? You choose a value R in a random fashion, right? And you compute h of r concoordinated with some x, right? So you know a part of your input, r is known, right? X is not known, right? It is still infeasible to find the value of x such that you get hold of this hash value, right? Okay, in collision resistance we are asking to choose a pair x and y such that they map to h of x comma h, h of x and h of y are same, right? They map to the same hash value, right? In case of hiding, okay, even if a part of the input is known, okay, and hash value is also known, it is difficult to get hold of, compute the x value alone, okay, so that the hash value becomes the given value, okay? It's not going to be so easy, right? Such a hash function is called hiding, right? Okay, and by saying infeasible, you can't do it, right? But infeasibility is not so easy to achieve in any mathematical functions for that matter, so we slightly reduce that confusion to something called puzzle friendliness, right? So computing this unknown required x, okay, is significantly lesser than 2 to the power n, okay, where n is your output size, okay? If you remember, our hash function maps any input length to n bits, right? Okay, so you can't do it in any time better than 2 to the power n as time complexity, right? Okay, I mean, slightly lesser than that. If you can do it, you call such a hash function as puzzle friendly. I mean, hash function with puzzle friendly character, right? Yeah, SHA-256 satisfies this requirement also. Okay, it's not property to hiding, but it satisfies puzzle friendliness as a property. Okay. Yeah, Shining algorithm has these three components in it. Okay, first you need to generate keys, right, with the key size given to you, right? As I said, the key will have two components, the secret key and the public key. Public key can be used for locking or encrypting a message to the owner, or in case of signature, public key is used to verify the given signature, and secret key is used for signing, right? Okay. Signing is another algorithm. Given a message along with the secret key, it will give output as signature, right? And while verifying, what you verify with? You verify with the message along with its signature with the help of the public key, okay? And if it is valid, the return value will be is valid. If it is not, okay, it will say it's not valid, okay? Is valid is the question, it will say yes or no. Okay, two properties. Sorry. Okay. Two important properties that a signature scheme has to hold. Okay, when you verify with the help of public key and the message, a signature that you got from the message with the secret key, I mean a valid triple is verified, it will definitely return true, right? And if you verify some nonsensical stuff in place of signature, then it has to return false. Okay, that's one important requirement. Okay, in fact, this verify will be returning true is an if and only if condition, right? Next, signature should be existentially unforgeable. Okay, yeah, what does this mean? Okay, signing the given message for a signature scheme will always be difficult, right? Existentially unforgeable means the capacity to sign a random message, even that should not be so easy, right? So those who know cryptography, you might have seen things such as RSA signature scheme, Elgamal signature scheme, and elliptic signature scheme, digital signature algorithm, DSA, okay? Such things you might have seen, right? There, any standard good textbook will be giving existential forgeability of, details of existential forgeability of Elgamal signature scheme, okay? Elgamal signature scheme can be forgeable for a random message, right? You can't forge for a given message, that's difficult even with Elgamal, right? But you can definitely cook up a random message along with its signature, which will return true when verified with the public. Okay, that is possible with Elgamal signature scheme, right? Okay, but I don't want to go into details. Elliptic curve signature scheme is not susceptible. Okay, you can't have an existential forgeability also. Okay, it is existentially unforgeable. That's why it is safe. Okay. A node initiates a transaction in a blockchain network by employing a digital signature. Right. What does this mean? What is a transaction? Before continuing, okay, first time we are coming across the word transaction. What do you mean by a transaction? In fact, to put it as fact, I asked Madam Anita to come a bit early today so that she can add a couple of slides to this presentation, one on transaction and one on verifiability. Okay. But unfortunately, I came late. She was very much in time, so I couldn't add those slides. But anyway, I can discuss, no problem. Okay. So can anyone, right? If Alice transfers one Bitcoin to Bob, you can call it as a transaction, right? So what are the requirements of a transaction? I would like to explain a bit about transactions before going further. Okay. So what are the requirements for Alice to transfer one Bitcoin to Bob? Anyone can answer. It's not to the same person. Okay, and I'm a person who always interacts a lot. Okay, in fact, I am a Blackboard guy. Had it been an offline class, okay, I would have made you answer more than what I speak. Okay, please answer. What is the basic requirement for Alice to be able to transfer one Bitcoin to Bob? Okay, If I ask you to give me 100 rupees, what's the first requirement for that?
The amount should be transferable, like it should be available with you.
Perfect. Okay. You must first have 100 rupees. If you don't have 100 rupees, how can you give that to me? It's impossible, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. First, Alice must own one Bitcoin. Only then he'll be able to transfer that Bitcoin to Bob. Right. So, how Bob Alice will be owning one Bitcoin? He should have bought it from some previous transaction, isn't it?
Mary, how yes, you sir. Can be a software engineer? Next.
Fine, coming back. So, Alice has to refer to a previous transaction through which he got that one Bitcoin. Okay. So, a transaction, and now Alice will be paying one Bitcoin to Bob, right? As we are calling it our transaction now, right? So, what Bob has to do to receive that one Bitcoin, he has to give his address. Okay. So, how you pay to your friend through a NEFT transaction? Okay, you always do some kind of NEFT transaction or GPay transaction or Paytm transaction, right? Okay, what will you use to do such a transaction? In case of GPay, what you do? How do you do GPay transactions? You all do GPay transactions, right? Okay, if I ask you to send me 100 rupees over GPay, what is the first question that you need to ask me?
What is your address? Like, what is the phone number which is...
Perfect. Okay, you need my phone number. Okay, only then you can send money to me. Or you have to scan a QR code, which also generate that phone number or required stuff. Right, okay. QR code will not do any great thing. Okay, it will simply have that phone number hidden in it. Okay, once it is scanned, the phone number automatically pops up along with the name. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
If you have any question, please feel free to ask. Okay, I'm here only to answer your questions. Okay, not for any other thing. Right. Okay. In a similar way, in Bitcoin transaction, not phone number, an address is given. Right. Why this address instead of phone number? If it is phone number, it is always related to the Bob. Okay, you Bob will be having 1, 2, 3, or 4 numbers at the most. Okay, you can't have infinite numbers with him, right? Infinite phone numbers with him. Okay, so based on the phone number or such thing, anybody can be easily tracked. Okay, that happens with your GPay also, right? Once I say my phone number, you type that phone number in your Google Pay, it will immediately show my name, isn't it?
Already connected with the name, so
correct. Okay, so you will automatically get to know to whom you are paying, right?
Yes.
Whereas Bitcoin transactions are known to be anonymous. Okay, that is one extra feature which Bitcoin built into its technology, right? It don't want the user to be identified, okay, while doing transactions, right? To avoid this, what they tried for is, okay, they tried to generate different addresses while receiving money. Okay, Bob will give a newly generated address to Alice. Okay, Alice will be paying his money, I mean his one Bitcoin, to that particular new address which he gets from Bob, right? And Bob will receive that from his end, right? So how this new address will be popping up? Okay, so how you do Bitcoin transactions? Any of you know that? Nowadays, even televisions have so many advertisements for Bitcoin transactions, right? For many cryptocurrencies, for that matter. Okay, you have so many wallets or apps. Okay, you can download them to your phone, right? And start transacting with cryptocurrencies, right? Okay, anyway, I'm not here to advertise for them, but there are hundreds of such things available in India also, right? Okay, assume you have one such wallet in your phone. Okay, wallet means something like your Paytm or Google Pay. It's not anything new to you now, right? That wallet, for every receiving transaction, will be generating a pair of secret key and public key, which you are seeing in the second line of this slide. Okay, For every new transaction through which it receives money, the wallet will be generating a new pair of secret key and public key. Secret key is stored in the wallet itself. That will not be revealed to anyone. Whereas public key will be given to the sender. Okay, I mean, in this case, to Alais. Okay, Bob's wallet will send a public key which is generated by it to Alais. And Alais will be paying his $1 to that public key. Right? But Alais received this $1 from some previous transaction as already agreed by us. Right? So he will be having a pair of secret key and public key in his wallet, Alais's wallet. Right? So Alais will be using his secret key to sign for spending this public, I mean, the corresponding public key through which he got the money, $1, I mean, one Bitcoin. Right? Okay. When that particular signature is mapped correctly, okay, is verified correctly, then the transaction becomes a valid transaction and it gets proceeded, right? Okay, and there is also another requirement. Alais should not have spent the same one Bitcoin earlier, okay? If it is already spent, he can't spend it again, okay? You can spend 100 rupees that is with you only once, right? Okay, you can't reuse the same 100 rupees multiple times. Right, double spending should not be possible. Right, and to avoid such double spending, what Bitcoin as a blockchain technology does is it maintains a list of unspent transactions. Okay, so the transaction through which Alais got this one Bitcoin should be there in the list of unspent transactions. Only then he'll be able to spend it. Right, these are few important aspects of transaction which we need to understand before we continue further, right? Alais to spend his one Bitcoin will be signing the transaction with the secret key that is stored in his wallet, and he will be sending the money to the public key address that he gets from Bob. Okay, that is Bob's public key. Okay, he sends that one Bitcoin to Bob's public key. Okay, there are two pairs of keys involved in this process. Alais's pair of secret key and public key, which authenticates the transaction, right, by using a proper signature, and Bob's pair of secret key and public key, okay, through which the Bitcoin will be received by Bob by just sharing the public key alone. Okay, he will not share his secret key. Okay, anyone who knows Bob's secret key can also use his Bitcoin. Okay, please remember this important aspect, right? And where this secret key is remembered for the use of Bob in future, it is in the wallet of Bob. It's not in any other place. Even Bob will not be seeing it directly, but he will be having capacity to see that. He can ask his wallet to show all his secret keys and matching Bitcoins that he received with that secret key, right? So he can see them and he can also write them on a piece of paper and whatever he wants he can do, okay? But he prefers to leave them only in his wallet as a storage, okay? And if he happens to lose his phone or if he happens to have some problem with his phone where his wallet gets erased, then he'll be losing his all Bitcoins also. There is no way on this earth to retrieve them back. Okay, this is one important aspect one has to remember when talking about Bitcoins or any cryptocurrencies for that matter. Okay, memory of your secret keys is very vital. If you happen to miss or forget your secret keys, it's a gone case. Okay, how many of you forgot your banking passwords and ask for a resetting them? We keep doing this always, right? Okay, at least I do it once in a month. Okay, whenever I get my salary, I'll forget my previous password and I'll ask for a reset. Only then I can draw my salary. Okay, and after spending it in that month, by next month I'll again forget it. Okay, that's my way of living. Okay, but when I deal with cryptocurrencies, I'm not going to have such a luxury. I have to remember my secret keys and access to my wallet and everything. Okay, if I happen to forget it, okay, that will spell an end of my cryptocurrencies. Okay, Yeah, valid password, maybe I should be able to reset it. Okay. But if something happens to the wallet itself, okay, then I am at serious loss. Okay, there is no way that I can get back my secret keys unless they are stored by me at a different location where I can retrieve them at a later stage. Right? And usually these apps also recommend to go with such procedure. Okay, fine, let's continue. Okay, the last line says, a node initiates a transaction in a blockchain network by employing a digital signature, yeah, Alay signs, okay, with his secret key, a digital signature, so that he can spend that one Bitcoin that he already has. That's how he initiates a process. And also, it will be received by Bob through his public key. Okay, fine. So, in general, okay, this public key are managed by an entity called PKI, okay, which is mean public key infrastructure, right? Where he'll be certifying that this public key belongs to so and so in person or entity, right? And that kind of certifying process will automatically connect the user with the public key, okay? And because of that, okay, it's not suitable for blockchain applications, okay? As I said, blockchain application maintains some kind of anonymity of the user with the transaction, right? Okay, though it's not fully secure anonymity, okay? Some of the speakers, I mean, Rukmareka will also be talking about it in her speak, in her speech a bit, okay? Though she may not go into details, okay, this anonymity is not very true. Okay, I mean, there are attacks which can reveal this anonymity, I mean, which can relink the public keys with the users, right? And how to stop that is again a transaction level privacy requirement on which, okay, some kind of work is happening. Okay, that's also an interesting area to work with in cryptography, I mean, in blockchain technology, right? And in case of PKI, signature verification is same as identity verification. As I said, we don't want such a thing in blockchain, so we'll move away from having anything like PKI here, right? Instead, we already said, okay, for every transaction, the wallet will be generating a new pair of secret key and public key. Okay, and it will be receiving through that new public key, the bunch of Bitcoins for that transaction, right? Okay, so there can be so many different public keys associated with the same user. Okay, blockchain allows key pairs to be generated by users themselves. Okay, instead of themselves, you can call them as wallets. And we don't want any central management of these keys as PKI. Okay.
Yeah.
Now we go a bit deep into understanding blockchain structures, right? Each block points to the immediately previous block by a hash value of the previous block called parent block, right? This uncle block, orphan block. Okay, we don't want to talk about such things now. Okay, we'll talk later when it is appropriate. Okay. Okay, as I said, we might have started with block one. Okay, block one might not have any previous block weight. Okay, that can be the genesis block, right? Oh, sorry, block zero. Okay, block zero can be genesis block. Right, block zero's header will have some hash value that is stored in the header of block one. Along with that, you also have hash value of all transactions that sit in block one, right? That is also stored as an entry in block one header. Okay, and similarly, block one header's hash value is stored in block two, Right. And transaction hash value of block 2 are also stored in the header of block 2. Okay. See, this is how these blocks are linked. Okay. For every block, its previous block's header's hash value is stored in the header of that particular block. Right. Okay. You can see that nicely given in this diagram. Okay. Again, thanks to Anita for picking up such a good diagram, okay, or Rukma, whoever it is. Okay, they have picked up a nice diagram for me to explain. Okay. So, this is in general a brief structure of a block, right? 4 bytes will indicate what's the size of this particular block. Okay, first 4 bytes of your block will be indicating size of the block in bytes, right? And next 80 bytes is your header, okay, block's header, right? Normally those people who are from TCP/IP or who are from networks or any other related areas might know what a header means. Okay, each packet can have a header for itself. Okay, similarly each block also has a header, right? And the size of that header is exactly 80 bytes. Okay, what goes into this 80 bytes, we'll see in our next slide, right? And then comes a variable size 1 to 9 bytes, where you'll be recording transaction counter, which indicates how many transactions are in this particular block, right? And the remaining size is variable, it's not a fixed size. Okay, we'll have the list of transactions. If it is variable, how will you know where the block ends? That is given in the very first 4 bytes, right? Block size indicates what's the remaining size available for this particular block. Okay, so in fact, I could have preferred writing this variable as block size minus these many bytes. Okay, so you can even think it that way. But better to remember this block structure. Okay, now we'll see what's there in the header. Block header again has these entries in it, and these are all fixed sizes. Okay, first 4 bytes to record the version of the blockchain technology that you are using, okay, version of the software, okay. That space of 4 bytes is reserved to write the version. Okay, this is not such an important entry for us to understand, whereas the remaining entries are very, very important for us to figure out. All right, and next 32 bytes, previous block hash. Right, one second. Okay, you see, hash of previous block header. Okay, is recorded here, that takes 32 bytes, right? Why 32 bytes? Because we'll be using SHA-256. SHA-256 means 256-bit output. 256-bit output is exactly 32 bytes, okay? So that's why you reserve 32 bytes of space for that entry, right? Similarly, hash value of all transactions that sit inside this block are to be recorded, right? Okay, that is another 32 bytes, which is called as Merkle root. Okay, I'll explain a bit about Merkle root also, okay, how it is computed and all such things. Okay, but here we understand that it is also a 32 byte entry which sits inside our header. Okay, next is timestamp, which says approximate creation time of this block. Okay, when you started mining this block is called timestamp. What's meant by mining? We'll discuss about that towards end of this topic, today's session. And also we have another session about consensus where we'll talk about it in detail. Okay. Next comes difficulty target, a 4-byte value, nonce, another 4-byte value. Okay, these two become crux of understanding what is meant by proof of work, which is the consensus algorithm for Bitcoin network, right? Okay, we'll see if possible in today's session or maybe in next session, which is entirely dedicated for this topic, right? Okay, these are two other important entries which go into our header. Okay, we'll try to understand the use of each of them now. Yeah. Okay. Version number, as I said, is not very great entry we need to bother about. Okay, for every version of at any point of time, wherever you are using a particular version, you definitely have some version number associated with it. Okay, even with your operating system that you are using in your laptop or PC, you can go and check the version number of your operating system, right? Okay, that can be easily obtained and it can be stored in the first 4 bytes. And next 32 bytes is just hash of the previous block's header. Okay, that is just a direct hash value. Okay, just by employing SHA-256, you get this value also. Whereas Merkle root, hash value of current blocks transactions, how you get them is one small thing which we need to understand, right? Okay, we understand this with the help of a small example where we consider only 4 transactions, right? A, B, C, D are my transactions. What I do, I hash each of them independently, hash of A, hash of B, hash of C, hash of T. Okay, they can be leaves of my tree, Merkle tree, which I am constructing, right? I always paint them as 2 to the power n form, right? Here 4 itself is 2 to the power 2, so they are paid in 2 pairs, right? Okay, if they are 2 to the power n, I'll have 2 to the power n leaves like this, right? So 2 adjacent HA and HB. This plus indicates concatenation operation. Okay, I mean, they are just written adjacent to each other. HA followed by HB. Okay, just put them together, hash them again. Okay, that becomes parent node of this leaf nodes HA and HB. Similarly, concatenation of HC, HD is hashed again. That becomes parent node of HC and HD independently. Right, okay. Again, at this level, concatenate these 2 values at these nodes, okay, H of HA, HB plus H of HC, HD, okay, are again concatenated together and hashed again. That will become root of the small Merkle tree which has only 4 transactions in it, right? Say this root value is stored in hash of hash of the current block transactions. Okay, so in any block, the transactions are all put into Merkle tree, right? And you get Merkle root, and that Merkle root is stored here, right? Okay, that's why the 32 bytes is called as Merkle root. Okay, so why it is so important? Assume someone tries to manipulate the value of some entry in A, okay, so they can replace the recipient's public key with his own public key, or they can change the amount of, the value of Bitcoin that goes into the transaction, or any kind of change, okay, if they want to do and manipulate a transaction. Okay, let us assume somebody wants to manipulate and change the value, some value in A. So what will happen? That will automatically change the hash value of A. Okay. Once the hash value of A changes, the hash value of its parent should also change, right? So cryptographic hash functions is so crazy. Even a single bit change in input, a single bit change in input will result in change of half length output. Okay. In 256, 128-bit outputs will be changing badly, okay, we'll be switching to some new value, right? Okay, so any manipulation to A can have a drastic effect on all its parents up to the root, right? So Merkle root value will also be changing to a new value, right? So you have to change the entry which is written as Merkle root for editing a particular single transaction in that block. Okay, Merkle root value will be drastically changing. Okay, as I said, a single bit change will result to half length change. Okay, if you change a public key address, okay, that's a significant change, right? So it will result in drastic change in the Merkle root. Okay, there will not be any comparison between the previous entry and the current entry. Okay, so how is it difficult? One second. If you change a transaction in block one, that will change the Merkle root entry in block one. Okay, so once this header has a small change in it, then it will change the hash value of previous block in block two. Okay, so once there is a small change here, that will again change the hash value of previous block in block three, right? So up to the recent, most recent block, every block undergoes through some entry change, right? To manipulate a single transaction in a particular block, you have to edit the entries in all these blocks, right? So you have to compute so many Merkle roots repeatedly. Yeah, so many hash values repeatedly. Okay, you have to compute one Merkle root where the transaction undergoes a change, and repeatedly you have to hash the block header again and again and change the entry in the next block, right? Okay, so this becomes a chain of changes. Is it so difficult to do all these changes? Yes, it is very difficult. Even to manipulate a single block, it is a difficult process. And if time permits, we'll demonstrate with some live web page in our next session. Right, next session is 23rd, okay, during that consensus session, right? Okay, you will understand how difficult it is. But for a single block, it is okay. Relatively, you can do it with some ease, right? But when you keep doing it for a number of blocks, okay, your headache will be compounded. In general, it is believed that a transaction is safe once it is under six blocks on top of it, okay? And for every 10 minutes, a new block gets added to your Bitcoin network, right? Means in an hour, six new blocks will be added, okay, and transaction will become something very secure. Okay, manipulating that is difficult, right? Okay, why it is difficult? Okay, when we talk about consensus algorithm, it will be discussed in elaborate. Okay, right now you just believe. Yeah, that's all about Merkle tree and few topics about Merkle tree. I believe we might have discussed it. Anyway, let me read. Is a binary search tree. Okay, I'll say why it is binary search tree with some detail. Transactions are organized as a Merkle tree, and Merkle root is the block hash. If you change the transaction, you need to change all the subsequent block hashes. Yeah, and there is also another interesting feature to this Merkle tree, and why our friend tried prefer to call it as binary search tree. I'll explain that very shortly, but let me continue with the slides before coming back to Merkle. Yeah, blockchain architecture. Okay, data layer talks about data blocks, chain structure, timestamp, hash functions, Merkle tree, and digital signatures. We almost discussed these topics. Okay, and it has a network layer where you have a physical network, which I can call as peer-to-peer network, and transmission protocol, how these transactions are propagated to the other network, and what's the verification mechanism, and a consensus layer where there will be different consensus algorithms, power of proof of work, proof of stakes, okay, and various other things which we'll discuss later. Okay, and in particular, Bitcoin network will be using a particular algorithm called proof of work. Okay, we spend a bit about that in today's session. Okay, And the next is incentive layer, where the successful miner will be given some kind of incentive for mining it successfully. And apart from that, each transaction may have some transaction fee associated with it, right? That can also become an incentive for successful miner, right? And contract layer, okay, these are specific for different kind of blockchains, which are permission blockchains. People will be talking about these things in permission blockchains, which I am not going to deal with. Okay, and next, application layer comes with programmable currencies and programmable finance and programmable society. Okay, these also, okay, so at least for us, the application layer is the wallets that we are talking about, okay, which are there as an application for you, okay, which can generate your keys and which can allow you to receive money, spend money and various, I mean, spend run bitcoins, not money, okay, receive and spend bitcoins. And yeah, it provides you various kind of applications. Okay, as I said, you can ask the application to show all your secret keys and associated bitcoins that you got with those keys. Okay, you can note down them separately, okay, or you can even ask it to give a printout. Okay, that's also possible. Okay, such things are your application features. Yeah, next. As I said, you have a peer-to-peer network as the basic structure of your network. On top of it, you have a chain of blocks sitting with many of these nodes in your network, right? Why many? No, why not all? Okay, say I am just a user of Bitcoin. Okay, I don't want to mine Bitcoins, or I don't want to become a full node where I store every detail of Bitcoin transactions. Okay, as a user, what I'll be having, I'll be just having a wallet in my mobile phone, and I can get Bitcoins. I mean, I can receive Bitcoins through my wallet, and I can spend Bitcoins using my wallet. That's all. Okay. Whereas, let us assume I'm going to a hotel and use my wallet to pay some 0.5 Bitcoins to that hotel as my hotel staying expenses. Okay. Okay, even 0.5 Bitcoin goes into lakhs, right? Okay, let us assume 0.05 Bitcoins, okay, as my hotel cost for staying there for some week, okay, 1 week, right? So hotel fellow will also receive money through the same similar kind of wallet from his end. Maybe he'll be having a bigger or more sophisticated application, but he also will not be interested in storing every detail of your complete blocks list, right? He don't want to become a complete full node, right? Whereas there can be nodes which receive this transaction, which validate this transaction, and which mine these transactions. Okay, so there are different kinds of nodes. A normal user like me, and also a similar but a bigger user like a coffee hotel or a hotel where I stay, right? And another node can be a full node where every block is stored, okay, which can validate the transaction and which can mine new transactions, new blocks also, right? Okay, there are different kinds of nodes. User nodes, simpler nodes which do some extra verification also, okay, and nodes which do actual storing of all transactions, which are full nodes, right? So simple nodes, they don't do any verification by themselves. All they do, they'll send it to the nearest node which can do the verification. Okay, I'll just generate a transaction to spend my Bitcoin, or I'll just generate a public address to receive the Bitcoin. That's all. I'll not do any verification from my end, right? Whereas hotel can be a bigger node which can do verification also, but as I said, it will not have all blocks with it, Okay, it has to rely on some full node to have that information, right? Okay, what it can do, it can use Merkle tree to Merkle tree, okay, which we have already seen, to validate this particular transaction. Okay, say for instance, I want to pay, as I said, 0.05 Bitcoin to hotel. Okay, I sign my previous entry through which I got some Bitcoin and send it to the hotel node. Okay, hotel node, instead of believing on a full node like me, it will ask full node for some details. Okay, it will receive those details and it can itself validate. Okay, it's a simple verification node. Okay, it can itself validate my transaction and then accept my transaction. Okay, and it will be sent to the full node as in a regular fashion to mine it again. Okay, these things we can discuss. Okay, how this simple validation can be done with the help of Merkle tree. Okay, it will not send the complete transaction to the full node. Okay, because it won't, don't want to, it will not believe that full node also. As I said, these nodes will not trust each other, right? It will send only some parts of the transaction, okay, through which I am paying to hotel. Okay, I mean my previous transaction, right? I am using a previous transaction to pay now a new transaction to the hotel, right? That previous transaction glimpses, okay, parts of it will be sent to the full node so that it can identify which transaction in which block it is sitting, right? And it will go to the particular block, right? Okay, and it will recreate the Merkle tree of that block, right? Assume the previous transaction based on which I am sending is B, right? So it knows what is hash B, okay, because it already identified what B is, right? That full node, it knows what is hash B, okay. And it also knows what is the corresponding pay, hash A. Okay, so it will send hash A. The parent node is hash of hash AB, right? And the pair hash of C plus T. Okay, this pairing node will be sent to me along with the Merkle node. Okay, with the hotel, right? See, this and this are sent. Hash of A, hash of C plus D, hash of A plus B plus C plus D. Okay, these all values are sent to the hotel node. Hotel node itself can compute hash of B. Okay, and it can combine them to give hash of A plus B. And it can combine that with hash of A plus B plus C plus D and again hash it to get the computed root by itself. Right. It already received the Merkle root from the full node also. It can compare these two values. If they match, it can believe that B is a valid transaction. Okay. If it fails to match, I mean the computed root and the received Merkle root, if they fail to match, it can simply reject the transaction as a false transaction. Am I clear? Okay. It could have simply asked the full node, is this previous transaction existing in your block? The full node could have said yes or no. Okay, then it has to believe the full node. Okay, instead of trusting it, it receives this Merkle path, okay, an altering Merkle path, and it computes Merkle root by itself, and it can verify or compare the received Merkle root with computed Merkle root. If they match, can validate the transaction as a valid transaction. Am I clear? Signature verification will be done only by the full node. Okay, but presence of a particular transaction can be verified by a special verifying node also without having the block, the full block with it. Right, this reduces even the cost of sending the whole block for verification and such things, or simply believing the full node. Okay, no such thing is required, but still you can do a validation or verification just by using the help of Merkle tree. Okay, good, let's continue. Okay, that's why I prefer to call it as a binary search tree. Okay, because of its binary character, I could be able to give the altering path and do my search with ease. Okay, good. Yeah. Okay, as we are saying, the base network on top of it, the global ledger, the chain of blocks that we are talking, and on top of it, various applications. Bitcoin is one application, and the other currency applications like Ethereum. Hyperledger is permission Bitcoin, where you do different kinds of applications, and there are a list of various other applications. And I believe different people will be talking about different applications you see on the topmost layer. Okay. Okay, now we'll again come back to the transactions and discuss a bit about how they can be mined. Okay, different stages of mining. Okay, one particular process is the consensus process, proof of work. Okay, we'll either talk about it today or in next class. Okay, I'm left with 10 more minutes. Okay, so definitely it will go to the next class. Okay, I mean, that is 23rd at 11:30 or so. I'm not sure about the time, but 23rd, second session of 23rd. Okay, all transactions are stored in, okay, whichever transaction that comes to the full node, which are also called as miners. Okay, the received transactions are all kept in a pool. Okay, and these transactions are also propagated to other full nodes with the help of a gossip protocol. What is meant by gossip protocol? Just broadcast it to all full nodes. Okay, and they receive them whenever they happen to get their network complete. Okay, I mean, whenever it reaches it. Okay, we need not bother much about it. Okay, assume I propagate a particular transaction as a full node to 10 nearest full nodes. Okay, it will be received by 8 and it will not be received by 2. I just don't care about it. Whichever node receives it, okay, it keeps it in its pool and again propagates it to the neighboring nodes of it. Okay, a particular transaction can be received by a particular node multiple times also, but it will not store it multiple times. It will only store once. Okay, these are features of your gossip protocol, right? So every transaction will be sent to as many full nodes as possible, and it will be there in the transaction pool of that full node. Okay, and from the pool, it will pick some bunch of transactions, okay, which are good enough to be mined in a particular block, right? And it will start building the block with these entries. Right? Okay, transactions will sit in the last space of the block memory, right? Transaction counter, number of transactions in that is written on top of it, and block header comes on top of it, along with the size of this block is written at the first entry, very first entry. Okay, as we already seen, the block header will have these very entries. Okay, version, previous block, and Merkle root value. We already discussed how to compute these things. Timestamp, the current time when you start mining this block, right? Okay, you have the difficulty and target, we'll discuss in next session. Okay. Then, okay, whichever node which receives the transaction will validate the transaction. What is meant by validating the transaction? Okay. I'll very quickly discuss this now, and also possibly in next session I'll spend a bit on this also. Right, validating the transaction, you validate the signature is associated with. First, you check for the availability of the previous transaction through which the person who is paying the Bitcoin is claiming to pay is present in your block, and it's also present in your unspent list. And third, the signature has to be verified correctly, right? Based on all and such validation procedures, a transaction is validated. Okay. From all these validated transactions in the pool, okay, as I said, the number of transactions are picked. Miner nodes need to solve, okay, this is proof of work. Okay, miner who can solve the puzzle successfully will become the winner. Okay, a small amount of incentive is given for successfully creating a new block, right? What is this puzzle? As I said, we'll discuss in consensus. Okay, all the peers in the network then verify the new block using a consensus mechanism, right? Here consensus is not a separate mechanism, okay? It goes just in the process of mining itself, okay? But once it is properly mined, it's again the block is sent to all other full nodes, and they again just recheck the consensus mechanism. That's why it's written in this stage also. Now new block will be added to the existing chain, and then transactions are confirmed. Okay, it's not so simple. Okay, there is a possibility of something called fork. Okay, let us see if our next slide talks about it. The next block links itself with the new block using a cryptographic hash pointer, right? And the now the block obtains its first confirmation, while the transaction obtains the second confirmation. Okay, why second confirmation for transaction? Transactions are already confirmed when they were verified. Okay, when they are mined in a block, it's their second confirmation, right? In general, transaction needs 6 confirmations in a network to be considered final. After 6, you don't have any problem with that. Why a problem before 6? If a particular block is to be extended with a new block, okay, and there are so many miners across the world, okay, assume 2 different miners successfully mine 2 different blocks. Okay, they will be propagated to the other full nodes. Okay, some full nodes will receive, okay, assume them as block 1 and block 2, okay, BX and BY. Okay, some of the full nodes will receive BX first, and some of the full nodes will receive BY first, right? But you don't know which is the one to be accepted, which is the one to be rejected. Okay, there is nothing like that. Okay, both are added to the existing list, right? As 2 different branches. Okay, in a tree, you see, tree can have multiple branches, right? Like that, parent node has 2 children, right? Both are added in all full nodes, right? But every full node will continue to extend the node, I mean the block, which it receives first. Okay, a particular full node which receives BX first will extend BX. A particular full node which receives BY first will extend BY. Okay, after some 2 or 3 new cycles, okay, each full node will check which branch is longer. The shorter shorter branch will be truncated. Okay, and the transactions in those blocks are all returned to the pool if they are not already there in the second branch. Okay, some of those transactions can be there in the second branch also. Okay, BX and BY may have some common transactions, right? Okay, and whatever is extended might not be common there in the other pools, other blocks, but whatever is not there already in the second branch, I mean existing continued branch, okay, they'll all be returned to the pool again, and because of their long waiting time, they'll be having higher priority, so they'll be mined immediately in the next block, right? I hope you understood this. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Okay, so this is again a pictorial description of the same stuff. Transaction requested, authenticated first, and then block, it's added in the block, right? And the block is sent to every node. Okay, nodes validate the transactions in the block and also the block itself. Node receive a reward for proof of work, typically some cryptocurrencies. Block is added to the existing chain, right? And here there can be a possibility of fork, and we discussed how the fork will be dealt with. The update is distributed across the network, and the complete network will have this new block. Okay, and the transaction is complete. 6 more blocks will say that is final. Okay. Characteristics of blockchain: decentralization. Okay, as we have been talking about it, it's a decentralized public ledger, right, which is sitting on a peer-to-peer network, okay, and hence it's a peer-to-peer transaction system. Persistency: immutable distributed ledger, okay, and nearly impossible to tamper. Okay, we already discussed this, but we'll say why it is difficult when we talk about consensus. Anonymity: user interact with a generated address. Okay, as I said, every transaction you will be receiving new Bitcoins with a new address to create some kind of anonymity, but there is no guarantee on perfect privacy preservation because these addresses can be linked to a person with the help of some very new research. Okay. And all transactions are recorded along with digital timestamp, and always audit and trace previous records to transparent transactions. So you can easily audit this transaction. Okay. Types of blockchain. We are talking about public blockchains. Okay. Because Bitcoin is a public blockchain. Okay. And other types of blockchains are consortium blockchains and private blockchains. In public blockchain, they are open to anyone. Everyone can read and write. We have read and write permissions. Even if you have enough money, you can become a miner in Bitcoin currency. Okay. All that you need to is to have a big computing capacity and storing capacity to store all blocks and also to successfully mine new blocks. Okay. You don't need permission from anyone. Okay. Everything is available open. Whereas in consortium blockchain, some number of organizations come together. Okay. And read permissions will be given to many. Whereas write permissions are limited to those organizations, right? And together they'll be dealing with the blockchain. Okay. Private blockchain is private to a particular organization, and they can give read permissions to open. It can be open to all, right? Within the network or within the organization or the users of organization also. Okay. Whereas write permissions can be restricted to the people who should be capable of writing. Okay. Say, for instance, if you want to put all train tickets into blockchain, right? Okay. With the current system, okay, without bothering about IRCTC kind of internet booking, right? Who will be given write permissions? Only ticket counter people and such people should be able to write, whereas everyone should be able to read it. Okay, still it's a private blockchain. Okay. I don't mean to say railways has such a blockchain now. Okay. They has to come up with some open architecture. Okay, because everybody like you and me can also do reservation. Okay. Again, the same details compared in a table. Okay, I don't want to discuss these things again. Okay, one point which I would like to bring to your attention is, in public blockchains, the efficiency will be low. As you move to consortium or private, the efficiency becomes increased. And consortium or private are centralized. Okay, in that order. Okay, consortium is partially centralized, private is completely centralized. Whereas public, there is nothing called centralization. And public blockchain is permissionless, the other two are permissioned. Yeah. Proof of work, we just defer it to the consensus session and we don't talk. I would like to say thank you. And if you have any questions, you can ask me now.